Hi everyone and welcome back to Newegg TV. My name is Paul and this is part two of our double Mini-ITX computer build series. We have two systems here that you saw me put together in part one. I have now loaded Windows onto both of these systems. If you're curious on how to properly install Windows, you can head over to part three of our How to Build a Computer series. We'll probably put a link for that right up here in this area somewhere. But these computers are good to go for right now. I have been doing some testing for power usage and thermals and just to see what they can do, particularly for home theater use. So I'm going to share some of those results with you, also show you some live playback. But first off, a quick aside, because these two computers definitely are not equal. They're both different builds, they're both at different price points, so please don't consider this as an apples to apples comparison. But this build in particular on the left here is using a Z68 chipset, and we have set it up for smart response. So I'm going to start off by showing you guys how to set that up. Now, apart from having a Z68 chipset motherboard, there are three things that you'll need to worry about if you want to set up smart response. Apart from this, it's pretty easy. First off, of course, you will want to have a mechanical hard drive that you want to accelerate. You'll want to have a small SSD like this one here. We're using the OCZ Vertex 30GB that's right there. You want to have those both plugged in to the controller on your motherboard that is controlled by the Z68 chipset. Very important thing, you will want to go into your BIOS before you load Windows and make sure you set it to RAID mode. Once you do that and you've loaded up Windows, you just want to pop up the Intel Rapid Storage Technology software here. You can download that from Intel or from your motherboard manufacturer's website. And up here, it will give you your current status, and it has a quick, easy button here called Enable Acceleration. Over on the right, we can see our 30GB disk and our 466GB formatted disk size for our 500GB Seagate. You can also do that right here under the Accelerate tab, but all you got to do is hit Enable Acceleration, tell it what to use. You want it to use the 30GB SSD. We want to use all of it. This is the disk that we're going to accelerate, the 500GB drive. We're going to go with it enhanced mode for right now. Hit OK, and there it goes. It's going to set this up. It sets up your 30GB as a cache volume, and then that's going to give you better hard drive response time by caching data to that SSD. Now that that's set up, let's go back to our testing of both of these systems. And now for some testing and test results. And our goal here is to see how these machines perform as home theater PCs. We also threw in a little bit of gaming, and we got a result for each test, if that applies. And we were also checking the temperatures, peak temperatures that is, for both the CPU and the GPU on both machines. We used hardware monitor for that, or HW monitor. And we also had both of the machines run down to a kilowatt meter down there, so we got both the average power draw as well as the peak power draw for each individual test. And for starters, let's do our most strenuous test, and go. That's the idle test. They're both idling right now. But here are your results. The Z68 Core i5 system over here idles at 37 watts. We had a temperature of 44°C on the CPU and 46°C on the GPU at idle. I did notice for the Z68 machine that the CPU temperatures, which usually we'll see around 20 or 30°C in most gaming machines, were higher. They were really more in line with the GPU temperatures. That's probably because they're both on the same die and they're both very close together. On our Fusion system right here, the E350, we had an idle power draw of 25 watts. The temperatures for the CPU was 22°C and the GPU is 50°C. So perhaps the sensors are different on here, maybe further apart. But we did see that difference between the CPU idle temperature and the GPU idle temperature. And that sort of goes across the board for all the tests that we ran. But next up, let's do some quick Windows Experience Index. Now here's our Windows Experience Index, and this is for the i5-2400S system. There we can see our results. For temperatures, we got up to 69 degrees Celsius on both the CPU and GPU during this test, and our power draw was 65 average and 96 watts max. Here we can see all the results, and it's based on the lowest score here is what you get for the overall score. We can see our processor scored 7.4. The 2400S is a very speedy processor. Now, if you're interested in this type of build and you don't want to go with something as powerful as the 2400S, actually a new chip that came out after I gathered the parts for this system is the Core i3-2105. That's also a 65-watt TDP chip, and it has the Intel HD 3000 graphics instead of 2000, so that's another option for you here. But if you want more processor speed, if you're using this, for example, as a server, you might be interested in that. Of course, we got solid scores for the rest of the build, and we have arrow capability, as you can see there. Then we got 5.8 for gaming graphics, 5.9 for the primary hard drive. Let's move over to our Fusion E350 results here. Here we can see our overall score of 3.8, and that's primarily due to the processor. The E350 is a little bit weaker on the processor side, but it does draw much less power. So for a home theater PC, it still did just fine in all of the rest of our tests, as you will see. You can see the rest of the scores there. And again, for graphics and gaming graphics, pretty solid scores due to the integrated 6000 series graphics for the E350. And again, as you can see here, it does arrow just fine. And for the E350 results, we hit 42C on the CPU and 71C on the GPU during the experience index test. And our power draw was 34 watts on average and 38 watts max. And next we're gonna jump right into the gaming benchmarks just because I like gaming. We did 3DMark, and you can see 3DMark Vantage running on the system over there. I wanted to do 11 and Vantage, but actually this system, the E350, is the only one that can run 3DMark 11. That is one advantage that it has with the integrated Radeon HD 6310 GPU in there, is it is DirectX 11 capable, so it can run 3DMark 11 versus the Intel HD 2000 graphics in this one, which is only DirectX 10 capable. So over here we can see our 3DMark 11 results. Again, this is for the Fusion E350. Got a score of P283, that's on performance mode. Graphics 255, physics 669, combined 276. Our wattage draw while we were running this test was 38 watts on average and 45 watts max. We hit 41 degrees max on the CPU and 70 degrees Celsius on the GPU. Also, we ran 3DMark Vantage on that, and although I forgot to take a screenshot of the scores, I did write the scores down. For 3DMark Vantage, our score was performance mode P649 was the points. Again, 40 degrees Celsius was our max temp on the CPU, 67 Celsius max temp on the GPU, and our wattage was 38 watts on average and 44 watts max. And of course, we did run 3DMark Vantage also on the i5-2400S system. It's running on entry mode right now, but we also ran it on performance. Our performance score was P1052 as far as the score we got. CPU temperature was 75C max. GPU temperature was 77C max. Those were the highest temperatures we saw for any of our tests. We also got up to 75 watts on average for power draw and 104 watts max. And again, that was our highest wattage draw for any of the tests that we ran. And next up, we have a popular game. This is World of Warcraft. I loaded up on both computers here. No, I don't want to join your group. But for starters, in order to get this to more playable frame rates, I was able to do the higher resolution, but I was only getting about 10 frames per second at that. In order to get about to 30 frames per second, and that is here in Orgrimmar where there's lots of stuff going on, I have it set to 1440 by 900 with fair settings. And it's playable, it looks fairly decent for a little integrated graphics computers here, not too bad at all. The temperatures, for starters, over here on the Fusion on the right, we hit 40C on the CPU and 69C on the GPU. Also, we're drawing about 40 watts on average and 44 watts maximum. Going over here to the Z68 i5-2400S, we were at 67 degrees Celsius and 70 degrees Celsius, respectively, for the CPU and the GPU. We were at about 72 watts power draw on average and 88 watts maximum. And now we're moving on to some more home theater PC related tasks, and this is Blu-ray playback. We got Inception over here, we got some Claymore over there, and I'm happy to say that both of these machines are able to completely playback Blu-ray, no hitches or snags or stutters or anything like that. It's just fantastic. So both of these are great for home theater if you want to do some Blu-ray playback. Just for our test results, since we were doing temperatures and wattages. For our Fusion machine over here, which is currently playing Inception, we scored about 41 degrees Celsius and 70 degrees Celsius, respectively, for the CPU and GPU temperatures during the playback. And the power draw was 44 watts on average and 47 watts on max. For our other system over here, which is currently playing back Claymore, that's the i5-2400S system, 53 degrees Celsius and 56 degrees Celsius, respectively, for CPU and GPU temperatures. 52 watts on average and 54 watts maximum during the Blu-ray playback. Now, apart from playing back Blu-rays, you might want some other high-definition content. So we wanted to run a test with an MKV file. So this is a 1080 MKV. This is Space Battleship Yamato, in case anyone's wondering. Right now, we're using the VLC media player to play it back. As you can see, both of these systems are playing it back just fine. Although I should mention that on our Fusion system, the CPU by itself was not quite enough to get this level of playback. We were getting some stutters when it was just using the CPU. VLC Media Player has a GPU acceleration option, so I turned that on with the horsepower of the GPU behind it. As you can see, it's playing back just fine. So for our results here, both were smooth. Once again, GPU acceleration needed for the E350, but not for the i5-2400S. Our temperatures for the E350, 34 degrees C and 60 C for the CPU and GPU, and power draw is 34 watts and 36 watts for average and peak. For our Z68 i5-2400S over there, we were at 55 C and 58 C for temperatures on the CPU and GPU. Yeah, and our power draw was 50 watts on average and 62 watts max. And lastly, for media playback, we're just doing a little bit of streaming video here. This is a 720p video playing from YouTube, and right now it's on the i5-2400S, as you can see right here. Ironically enough, hey, that's the same motherboard that's in this machine. Awesome. But for our temperatures for the 2400S, we are at 50 C and 52 C, respectively, for CPU and GPU. 50 watts on average, 51 watts peak for power draw. And same thing over here. Here is our Fusion E350 machine playing back, hey, why not, our Fusion E350 video on YouTube. Again, we're at 720, and the temperatures we were getting is 40 C and 67 C for CPU and GPU temperatures. And our wattage is 38 watts on average, 40 watts max during this streaming video playback. I also wanted to throw a few more tips out there for those of you guys who might be setting up a home theater PC, and that is that there are some front-end softwares that you can use to navigate through them, playback video, stream video from the internet. Boxy over here on the right is one of them. You can simply install the software on your home theater PC and set it up. You can browse through movies, TV shows, and apps. You can use it to playback files that are already on your computer over there. And it's pretty awesome. I've tried it out a few different times. Similarly, over here on the left side, we have Xbox Media Center. It's another option that's out there. Similar type of functionality. It's a front end you can use to organize and play back your music, videos, pictures, that sort of thing. And then we also have another one, which you might have heard of, and that's Windows Media Center. So now as we talk about Windows Media Center, I'm also going to talk about some other types of controls that you might want. So for this, for example, is a standard Windows Media Center remote. Comes with an infrared item right there that you can see, so you can launch Windows Media Center with the push of a button. It will pop up here on the screen. And then this is much better for use with a home theater PC, because you can use it from the couch to navigate through your movies and TV shows and other add-ons that you might use with Windows Media Center. Now, apart from a typical remote like that, you might want a little bit more control. So here's an item from iOGear. It is a wireless mini keyboard. It has a built-in little mouse trackball right there, and you can also use the thumb keyboard to, for instance, punch in searches, and it gives you a little bit more control without having to use the keypad there to punch in stuff that you're searching for. So mimics a little bit more of the full keyboard. We have another one over here. This one's from Citico, and this one is actually infrared, so as you can see, as I move it around on the screen there, it's got a mouse cursor that moves around on the screen just like that. Same sort of functions. You got left and right mouse click buttons there, and then a full thumb keyboard. So a few more options for those of you who are interested for controlling Windows Media Center and the computer in general, especially if you want to do that from your couch. And that is going to wrap it up for today's video. We hope you've learned a little bit more about these tiny little mini ITX computers, and also how easy it is to set up both an inexpensive, low power, low temperature, low noise computer for use in the living room or possibly as a home server. Also, some use case scenarios for playing back all your media, as well as maybe even a little bit of gaming. I'm Paul with Newegg TV. If you enjoyed today's video, please head over to our Newegg YouTube channel, and don't forget to subscribe. Thanks a lot for watching, and we will see you next time.